Well, good morning and welcome to our service this morning. It's lovely to see you here. It's great to welcome you. I'm Nick Grew. I'm on the ministry team here, and Sarah, our vicar, will be preaching to us later. It's lovely to see all of you here. I know it's a week of prayer for Christian unity, and so there's a kind of a congregation swap that goes on, and I believe we've got visitors from St. Martin here. Am I right? Wave to us if you're St. Martin. Welcome. You're very welcome, people. I think we've dispatched a contingent to another church as well. It's a very good idea. So we have tea and coffee afterwards. You're very welcome to stay, and we hope you will, so we can chat and get to know you a little better as welcome. To welcome to all of you, whether you're here, been here regularly, or here for the first time. Welcome on Zoom as well. It's lovely to see you here and to be here together, to worship together. And a big thanks to all those. If you think the church looks sparkling and clean, it's because it is. Thank you to all those who came yesterday to be part of the cleaning team. Spent yesterday morning. We all enjoyed a good breakfast beforehand, I confess. But there's great work been done. Thank you to all of you for all the work you've done to do this, to get the church ready for us. It's great. We're working our way through a series of sermons looking at the five marks of mission. And they tend to be described with T's. And so we've done tell and we've done teach. And we reach tend, and Sarah will be preaching to us more about that theme and what that looks like in terms of within the context of mission later on. But I found myself during the week, knowing I was leading this service, thinking about the word tend, and nagging in my mind was not just tend, but tenderness. And I was reminded that when Zechariah prays, prophesies really, after John the Baptist is born, he talks about the tender mercy of God, through whom the forgiveness of our sins is going to come through Jesus. And I just thought that tenderness of God towards us is something I just was very struck by during the week. And I was thinking about that bit in Hebrews where it says, when we look into heaven, there's one just like us there, knowing what it feels like to be where we are and where we've been. And therefore we can connect with God in a whole new way through that tenderness towards us, and the tender mercy of Jesus, who's been where we are and knows what it's like. And when we pray to him, says, yeah, I know exactly how that feels. So when we come at the beginning of our service, as we so often do, to say, Lord, we've mucked up during this week, and not just me personally, but we as a church, and, you know, we're not always as united as we should be, and we're part of a human race that seems to make a mess of far too many things. And so we just want to say sorry. He will come to us tenderly and mercifully and forgive us. And that's such a wonderful opening to our worship, because it means that we can come into his presence with an utter confidence of his welcome and his affirmation. So we're going to use some words on screen. It's a simple response. Each time the dark print is for you to say, the bold dark print is for you to be bold in replying. And so, in a dark and disfigured world, we've not held out the light of life. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. In a hungry and despairing world, we've failed to share our bread. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. In a cold and loveless world, we've kept the love of God to ourselves. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. God of all mercy, your Son proclaimed good news to the poor. May God, who loved the world so much that he sent his Son to be our Saviour, forgive us our sins and make us holy to serve him in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now we're going to join together in saying the collect that's set for this day that actually, wonderfully, Sarah and I realise, connects with the very theme that she's going to be talking about. So God must have been at work in this somewhere as well. So we're going to say this collect together as we say, God of all mercy, your Son proclaimed good news to the poor, release to the captives and freedom to the oppressed. Anoint us with your Holy Spirit and set all your people free to praise you in Christ our Lord. Amen. And so we are set free to praise, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to praise our God in heaven wholeheartedly and thoroughly in two great songs of praise, a hymn and a song. Let's stand together. If you can stand, please do, and let's sing this together.
In bright raiment, robust and aware.
glorious Lord, you are worthy to receive all honor and glory and praise, for you are worthy of this. Thank you, Lord, that you enable us to sing along with the angels and the hosts in heaven. It's such a fantastic feeling to know that we can worship the one God above all things. Lord, we worship you this morning and pray that our hearts may be open and responsive to your voice and your word to us. We open ourselves to you and pray that we may give you glory that is worthy of your name, through the power and in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please do sit down. Just a couple of things. First of all, just to pick up on something that Sarah said last week, and I just want to reinforce it again this week, where Sarah talked to us last week about all the different ways in which people contribute to the life of our church, and it's fantastic. But there was one particular issue that she raised with us, and I just want to raise you again and remind you, which is that we're in need of somebody to be the secretary to the church council. And that's a role that certainly means taking minutes, and it may be a little bit more as well. But it's if you feel that's your gifting, or if you can see someone else around and you think, they're just the right person for that. And my experience quite often, it's when somebody comes up to you and says, have you ever thought of, that you go, bother, yes I have. And that's God speaking, isn't it? So I better go and do it. So just if you, that's a helpful thing, we know one another well enough to know sometimes when you see someone, you think, that would be just right for them. So do think about that for yourself and for somebody else. And so we want to pray very much, Lord, that you will be speaking to our hearts and open them up that we may know who it is you're calling to fulfill that role. In the name of Jesus. Amen. The other thing we're going to do now, we often have a sort of open mic time, but we also want to try and do a little bit of time every so often to think about home groups and what they're like and what they do. They can be a mystery to some, but they're lovely to others. And I'm going to invite Steve to come and talk to us a bit about a home group. And we're going to try and do this occasionally, get a home group to kind of feed back. But as Steve negotiates his way to the front somehow through the trip hazards, there you go. Over to you.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Gosh, I've got some reaction back. Okay, so I'm a member of a house group. It's a Tuesday evening house group, so there are no guesses or prizes for guessing when we meet. We meet on a Tuesday evening, and we usually meet on Zoom. And there's a reason why we meet on Zoom, which we'll come to in a minute. But just to explain to you a bit about the group, we have about, he said, looking around at members of the group here, about 7, 8, 9 members, something like that, appearing on Zoom every Tuesday evening. And in the last few months and years, we've been looking at topics such as Isaiah and the Servant Songs. And we've looked at the Generous June series. We've also used the Shape material, and we've also used some of the stuff from the London Institute of Contemporary, if I get this right, London Institute for Contemporary Christianity, LICC, where we looked at growing on the front line, growing more like Jesus where we are. And we also looked at fruitfulness on the front line, which looked at making a difference for Jesus wherever we are. And more recently, we've studied the subject of prayer using the Prayer 24 material. And at the moment, we're following the sermon series on the five marks of mission. Now, as I said, we usually meet on Zoom. We usually meet for about an hour and a half. We've stuck with Zoom. We went onto Zoom during the COVID, but we stuck with Zoom as it helps those who kind of don't get home from work early enough to want to come out again in the evening and would therefore not probably be able to take part in a house group. But perhaps we should ask some members of the house group what they think of the Tuesday evening house group. Now, we have put together a Zoom recording, so hopefully, Brian, we could have that, please. Oh, no.
Okay, so as you know, in the church today, we're looking at house groups and a house group in particular. So what I would like to ask you is what do you like about attending a house group, or what do you get from a house group by attending every week?
Okay, I'll go first. I like that we get to study the Bible, we get to do things together, discuss things. is on Zoom, so that's really handy for me because I work quite late and I can just drop in, get home and start. But my main thing, the biggest thing I get out of the house group is the group of friends that I've made through that, the close Christian relationships I've built. So that's me.
Okay, thank you. I'm glad you mentioned friends. So yes, that's brilliant. Thank you. Jan, would you like to say something?
Sure. Well, what we like about the house group is the chance to get into quite a lot of depth about things from the services or just Christian issues in general. I mean, it is nice chatting after church services, but by the very nature of the sort of time constraints, it's never going to be very long or very in-depth. So by being in a little group, you sort of get to know the same people over a number of weeks, and then you can sort of build trust and, you know, remember things you've spoken about before. And yeah, we just really find that really helpful, don't we? And also, like Caroline said, it is a nice way of having a little subgroup within the church that you're actually, you know, quite good friends with, because you've got to know them quite well just because you know spend every week chatting to them. And what's lovely is that there are quite a lot of different personality types, aren't there? And they bring different sort of backgrounds and skills and knowledge. And yeah, some people are newer to the faith than others. And it's great because we can all just learn from each other anyway. We really like it, don't we? And we also love it being on Zoom. It's very convenient. And it means our animals can join in sometimes, but they don't always comply. This is little fluffy Griffin. Oh, perhaps not.
Hello.
But he doesn't always want to play ball.
It's Pepper.
Oh, Pepper.
That, thanks, Jan and Neil. Christine, would you like to say
something? Well, my reasons are fairly similar. I do enjoy discussing the Bible with others. I think it's really helpful not just to study in isolation. And I enjoy the different angles and thoughts that people have. I think that's very stimulating. And like the others, I'm really grateful for the friendships that I've made. And I'm particularly feeling, you know, we came here 3.5 years ago, and it's and then we hit COVID, and it was hard to get to know people really well. And so that's a very important part of being part of the group, which is really nice. It sort of takes a bit of time to trust sharing things with others, I think, and the group allows for that, which is really good. Like the others, I find meeting by Zoom very helpful because you don't particularly want to come out on a dark, wet winter evening. But we do meet every sort of 6 to 8 weeks in person, and that's really helpful too. Yeah, and I think maybe the only other thing I would just say is that there's a lot of laughter. It's a real good tonic, particularly when the animals make an appearance. But it's fun to belong to a group.
Okay, thank you all. I would just like to point out, you don't have to have a pet or an animal to join the house group. But thank you very much for taking part. Thank you.
Thank you. Just to reiterate, yes, you obviously don't have to have a dog, a cat, a ferret, a rat, a guinea pig, whatever it is, to be part of the group. But it is a very relaxed group, and personally I find it really helpful about learning about our faith and being able to discuss our faith and things to do with the Bible in such a group. Now, I know there are some of the people in the group in the church here today. Have I missed anything? Can I just... No, what? Food. I've missed food, haven't I? Yeah, okay, so when there's every 6 or 8 weeks we meet in person, we do have some biscuits and cakes and various other things, and we do meet at other times in various pubs and such and have meals together. So it is a very friendly a group to belong to. So if you're not part of a house group or you're thinking about it, then please do contact either Nick or Sarah, who are leading the house groups, in the first instance. But that's the Tuesday evening house group. Thank you.
Steve, thank you very much indeed. I should emphasise that I'm actually part of that. And I can reinforce all you've said there. Great people.
Great fun. So yeah, if you want to join a group, think about one, come and talk to us. So thanks, Steve. Thanks to all of you for that. And you'll hear from another group in about a month's time or so. That'd be great. So now I'm going to ask Sophie to come and read our Bible. It was going to be Mike, but Mike's not well, and Sophie stepped in to do this. So thank you so much for doing that for us. We're going to have our Bible reading now.
The first reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 5 to 8. As you know, and as God is our witness, we never came with words of flattery or with a pretext for greed. Nor did we seek praise from mortals, whether from you or from others, though we might have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks so much, Sophie, and it's lovely to see you all. Hello, I'm Sarah, I'm the vicar here. And is my mic on? Yes, it's not on mute. It's turned on, and I think you can now hear me as well. That's awesome. Hi, everybody. How good to see you. Hello, Zoomers. You couldn't hear me then, right? But you can now. Thank you so much, Nick. We have indeed been talking about mission at the moment, looking at the so-called five marks of mission. And they're, in my world, they're quite a recent concept. Sorry for all you much younger people, but they were developed right back in the 80s as a way to think about mission in quite a broad sense. And each week we're just taking one of the five marks of mission as we reflect as a church on who God is calling us to serve and how. But just for a moment, I want to take a step back and ask us, whose mission is it anyway? Because it can seem like a weighty responsibility as individuals or as a church that we should go out and evangelize everybody. Is it just me who sometimes feels that's quite a weighty thing? Maybe when I used to be in CUs and whatever at college, they felt quite a pressure that the responsibility lay solely on my shoulders. But there's absolutely awesome news for us all, because actually the mission is God's. And I wonder if we could have our first slide up, please, Brian. This is a really helpful concept as well. The mission of God, they love to give it a Latin name, the Missio Dei. And it's something I touched on in our newsletter this week, because I've been thinking about it. God's mission is to draw the world into his love. And God is at work in this world by the power of the Holy Spirit. And we're just simply invited to join in with what he is already doing. And as the church, we do have a responsibility. We're not off scot-free. We don't go and, you know, go down the pub and do nothing. Well, maybe we go down the pub and chat with people. But the point is, as a church, our job is to point to this work of God that he is already undertaking in the world. Could I have the next slide, please? Because I just wanted to bring this quote to you. I love it. That Leslie Newbegin was a missionary to India and a theologian. But he said this: church is to be a sign of God's kingdom, an instrument of the kingdom, and a foretaste of the kingdom. And I love the concept of the kingdom of God, the place where God is in charge, if you like, an extra dimension in that God is in charge in lots of places in our world, but we are praying that he would be wholly in charge, and we can't wait for the day that will come when Jesus returns, where his kingdom returns to earth in full. But at the moment, we, the church, are to be a sign of the kingdom here on earth, an instrument of the kingdom, and a foretaste of it. Well, as we also know, God's kingdom was ushered in by Jesus, and Jesus lived out all of the five marks of mission. So could we have the next slide, please? We've got this wonderful slide we've been using to think about the five marks of mission. We thought on our first week about teaching. No, we didn't, about telling, about proclaiming the good news of the kingdom. Last week, we thought about teaching the news of the kingdom, of baptizing and nurturing believers, and indeed keeping ourselves keen to learn more, Today, we're thinking about tending, that is, responding to human need with compassion. And we will be thinking next week about transforming unjust structures. Steve's going to help us do that. And then finally, to treasure the earth and safeguard creation. But Jesus embodied all of these marks of mission. He proclaimed the good news. As we know, he discipled others. He treasured creation, often illustrating his stories from nature. He came to transform society, bringing justice, and he came to tend to the needs that all of us have. And this is summed up by his mission statement from Luke 4, where Jesus announced that the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, and to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour. So it's just helpful as we think through these marks of mission that it's exactly what Jesus did. And today we are specifically thinking about the third mark of mission, one that we see marking so much of Jesus's time on earth, responding or tending to the human needs around him by loving service. So in order to think about this, I want to share with you a couple of stories about how that might look. Have a little look at what our Bible reading has to say, and then think about what God might be wanting to say to us this morning about that. So story one, we might otherwise entitle How Not to Do It. Now, this is a clip of a Channel 4 documentary from the early 90s, and you might recognise one of the people involved. I will cringe through this, but I hope it brings you some amusement. Could you press play, please, Brian?
A vital part of the medical work here is going out to the villages for regular clinics.
I think one of the happiest times is being out on patrol with the nurses, just enjoying their company and enjoying sharing with them about their lives out here and learning from them. The nurses here are trained to diagnose and to treat patients, and they do so much of the work. It makes me realise that I think that doctors at home are perhaps rather overrated.
Have you seen the hovercraft anywhere?
No.
No! We've lost it!
That way.
It could be somewhere in here, we've no idea.
Sorry. I certainly am, yes. It's good to get some experience at this immunisation stuff.
What's the importance of this sort of care?
Oh, it's really good. They've got a very good healthcare system here, primary healthcare, so that if you immunise the kids now, you save less money, save more money on hospital treatment later on, so they don't need to get all these illnesses.
Does it come as a shock to you, this sort of treatment?
It's a bit rough and ready, isn't it?
How are you coping?
Am I coping? I'm loving it. It's great. It's much more fun than GP surgery at home doing this sort of thing.
Have you seen the hovercraft anywhere? Thank you!
Both belts have gone.
Both belts have snapped.
Both belts.
Yeah. One snapped and the other one's slipping.
So it was not very far away, but it was after that, of course, we could go nowhere. We tried one. After the first one went, we tried to do asymmetric power and that didn't work at all. But now we've really come to a dead halt.
garden, and my grandfather would lament the moss in that very lawn. He would show us the plants that were coming through. He would find whatever was in season and lovingly exhibit it to us. He would look at his fruit trees in despair and note the black spot or the figs that were not coming into fruit or whatever it was. And then the following week, we'd go round to our house. Doesn't quite look like that, but anyway, we'd go round to our house and my parents would take him round the garden and we would just point out the successes and failures in that garden, very different garden. But they would just share the joys and the frustrations of gardening together. It was as simple as that. And I think that this image of visiting someone else's garden is actually really helpful when we're thinking about mission. I've got a book that I quite like and an author that I've learnt quite a lot from. His name is Roger Schroeder. And I'm going to read you a little about what he says. This is what he says. And he's talking about it as an illustration for mission. So let's hold that in our minds. One enters another's gardens not to compare its beauty and variety with one's own, but to appreciate another way of gardening, another way of arranging flower beds or vegetable patches, another way of pruning or weeding. One can always learn from another gardener, and although one may want to give advice about growing roses or tomatoes, it's probably best to wait until asked. One can call attention to the existence of weeds in the garden, but what one gardener may consider undesirable, another will consider the prettiest plant. A garden is a person's special place, and so one has to be respectful of that gardener's tastes and talents and the experience that they bring. When one develops a deeper relationship with the gardener, one can learn a lot and maybe even teach a bit too. He goes on to explain how we might think about mission as responding to an invitation into someone else's space, taking time to get to know them and taking opportunities to share their experiences. And I just want to read a final sentence from that book to summarise that. With time, trust, and in response to an invitation, a missionary can accompany the other in tending to the other's garden. At the same time, the missionary can learn so much about gardening in general and about the life-giving plants and weeds in his or her own garden. And as I say, that's an image that's really stuck with me about how we might respond to human need. If we jump into another person's space and advise them on how to do life, try and fix the sick plants ourselves or pull out what we think are weeds, it's as though we're invading their garden. It's a bit like going on a hovercraft expedition to Papua New Guinea. But listening and learning from one another, as we did in my grandfather's garden, seems to me far more attractive. Sometimes we'll have the opportunity to see that God is at work and to join in, tending the shoots of the kingdom of God. And at other times, God will enable us to learn in what may appear to be very surprising soil. And this story of tending a garden has echoes with our Bible reading today, where Paul is writing to the Thessalonian church. Could I have the next slide, please? We never came, I'm just going to read, that's the whole of the reading, I'm just going to pull out just a couple of bits. Paul said, we never come with words of flattery, but we were gentle among you, like a nurse tenderly caring for her own children. So deeply do we care for you that we are determined to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you have become very dear to us. So Paul shared the good news of God's love and hope by coming among the church in Thessalonica really gently and respectfully. He cared for them more than just to preach a sermon and leave, but instead he shared life with them over a period of time. He gained their respect and he took opportunities to tend their gardens, as it were, and to learn from them. And so we too have the opportunity and the privilege to keep our eyes open for the shoots of God's kingdom in lives around us. Where we are invited into someone else's garden, we may tend those shoots in the power of God's Spirit, the very same one who anointed Jesus to bring good news to the poor, to proclaim release to captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free. So finally, I wonder what God is saying to us here at St. Francis through this today. And I want to suggest three things. Could I have the first PowerPoint, please? So first, I believe that God has given us here at St. Francis a particular call and care to tend to the needs of our community. It's wonderful to have visitors from other churches, and we don't have exclusive rights on this at all. But we looked at our mission action plan here at St. Francis and felt a particular calling to children and families and to healing and wholeness. And we've just seen opportunities to tend shoots of God's kingdom in these patches. We've been invited to set up a chaplaincy with the general practice across the road. We have a good relationship with them, which we're so thankful for. We have no shortage of volunteers to grow and develop Cafe and Messy Church. And there's been lots of interest in our new support group that Hannah's set up, our children and families minister has set up, for under fives with special needs and their families. God seems to have called us in this particular direction, and doors have opened for us to pursue these projects. And that is so exciting. We've just got an opportunity to get to know people and to learn from them, to walk alongside them. Maybe sometimes we'll have an opportunity to pray for them, or to pray for them to pray for us. Maybe they'll want to know more about Jesus in due course, and we can be ready to take the opportunities that God gives. And you know, maybe they won't, and they are no less welcome. We are here just to be a blessing to our community. So I could have the second PowerPoint. Just the second one, don't get too excited. No, it was a spoiler alert there, wasn't it? So secondly, when we're talking about tending to the needs of people, let's be more like gardeners who are invited into each other's spaces rather than hovercraft expeditioners who bring unsolicited and potentially inappropriate advice. We're all people with needs of different sorts at different times. And as a church family, maybe we can determine, along with the Apostle Paul, to share with one another not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because, as Paul would say, we have become very dear to one another. And could I have the third one, please, Brian? Thank you. Thirdly, let's just remember that the mission is God's. Some of us might be prone to taking too much responsibility for another's garden. It might be that we end up giving unwanted advice or hanging on to jobs that someone else is called to do. I wonder if I'm hanging on to aspects of church communications. If you're sitting out there thinking, why don't you let me do the social media? Let's talk. I think some of us unwittingly have that tendency to hang on to responsibility. And maybe others of us are a little prone not to take responsibility. And it's usually because we're just not confident that we have the skills or the ability to help. And if that's you, can I just encourage you to ask God to show you a need that you can meet? Because I promise that he will do that. God loves us to share in the work of tending to the needs in his world, to invite others into our own gardens, to show us where he is already at work, and to invite us to join him in that work. May we have eyes to see the shoots of God's kingdom in our midst and ears to hear his invitation to participate in tending them. Amen.
Stories there, and lovely insights to take away. I wonder if you listen to the story.
Please do sit down, and I'm going to invite Katie to come and lead us into our intercessions. Thank you.
We pray. Father God, as we come to pray, we thank you so much for your love and tender care for us. Thank you for the immensity and the inexhaustibility of your love for us and for all people. We just spend a few moments now to breathe in your love and care for us, and breathe out your love and care for others in that rhythm. I thought we could spend a few moments just, you might want to bring in prayer a situation where you are caring for another person or for several people. Just focus on those, and as you breathe, we pray for patience, for strength, for perseverance, for humour, and for love. And then you might want to bring a prayer for a situation where you sense that you need care yourself. And we pray that we have honesty and grace to accept care from you, God, and from others. Shall we just bring ourselves as well? Father, we're also conscious of many situations in the world where people are right in the middle of horrific events, but also where there are individuals and communities caring, even in the middle of all that, even when it's putting themselves in great danger or very costly to care. We thank you for them. We don't know who they are, they don't get into the news, but we pray for each of them. We pray for those we have heard about, for the staff still working at NASA Hospital in Gaza, for aid workers in many places, for those working in refugee camps, for people defusing landmines and trying to care for communities struggling to rebuild and recover. Lord, may your strength be with each of those people. And nearer to home, we pray for carers everywhere in our own country, for those in healthcare, social care, prisons, care homes. Lord, we pray for those people very often working with the huge discomfort of knowing that they're not able to provide the care and the service they'd been trained to do and want to do because of the lack of resources and time. Father, we pray that you give them what they need and encourage them to keep going. We pray particularly for the junior doctors' strikes at the moment, that there will be a breakthrough. We pray locally for our GP surgeries, our hospitals, and the care going on in people's everyday lives. Pray for those caring for members of their own family, for elderly people, for children, and especially for young carers who are still children themselves, maybe caring for their parents. Lord, we thank you for the care that's going on in what seems like unspectacular places, but is so precious. We pray for our own, the caring in our own church, for home groups, for the footprints group caring for children and families with additional needs. And in our cycle of prayer for our local streets, we pray for Salcombe Close and Thirlstane Firs, for everybody living there. We pray for our wider community too, for the street pastors in Eastleigh, for Mike and the team who go out in that work, for Christians Against Poverty, for Fledge and the Eastleigh Basics Bank. And we're aware on our prayer chain of many different people, and for each of those people we know that there is a network of carers and people who are so concerned for them, so we bring them together to you. We pray for Heather's friend Scylla and her family, for Kathy's friend Michelle and her husband Dave and family. We continue to pray for Dunny's mum, for Liz and Phil, for Cliff's sister-in-law Lynn, for Mary Thomas's niece and family, for Jean and the Edwards family, for Rich, Dave, Rosemary, Pat and Linda, and everybody involved in those caring spheres. And we pray for the funeral coming up on Friday of Gordon Hayes. Pray for his family and the family of Jerry Bailey. And Lord, we pray for those who are continuing to grieve those they've lost, for Charlotte and her little son Jacob, grieving Michael. You want to just take a few moments to lift up anybody you are particularly conscious of. As we've prayed, you might want to just focus on one particular person or place or situation that's come to your mind. And I'm going to use the words adapted from a prayer by Gerard Kelly. It might be for those people, or it might be that you sense you need to pray this prayer for yourself, or both probably at the same time. So shall we just use these words? May he who is always around you surround you. May he who has gone before you be for you. May he who is beneath and above you love you. May he who invisibly holds you enfold you. May you know beyond the boundaries of knowing, and feel beyond the frailties of your feelings that you are loved. So as we think of the day and the week ahead, we think of the neighbours, friends, work colleagues who we will come into contact with, and think of the many different ways, Jesus, you cared for people. So we pray that you give us imagination and energy and your Holy Spirit to care for those people, even if it seems something small. Help us to listen and sense those moments. And we bring all our prayers to you in Jesus' name. And shall we just join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory, yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let's just remain in prayer for a moment as we just recall, acknowledge, Lord, your generosity towards us in so many ways, and we thank you for putting into our hearts the desire to give back to you, and for all those who've given in different ways into this church, financially in particular at the moment. We're thinking about that, and thank you for those gifts, and pray that they may be used wisely, that we may extend a hand of mercy and grace and love and the kingdom of God towards those who need to hear it. May our hearts be open to do that, we pray. Bless these offerings in the name of Jesus. Amen. Continuing to think about things of prayer, we've got some bands of marriage to pray, to bring to your attention. So I published the bands of marriage between Samuel John Reeves, who's from this parish, and Alice Frances Grace Carr, who's from Romsey Abbey. And this is for the second time of asking. If any of you know any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other, you're to declare it now or come and find me or Sarah afterwards. That will be helpful. Thank you. Let's pray. Lord, we pray for Samuel. We pray for Alice. Thank you for the love that's drawn them together. Thank you for the plans being made for their special day. We pray it would be a lovely day, a good day, a day where family and friends and others celebrate with them their marriage. And we pray for that marriage going on into the future, that you may establish it firm and fast, and that you will be an essential part of their relationship as they grow and nurture and support one another. May you bless them, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Other notices, I think generally things are as they would be this week. There's cafe and there's other things going on. There's footprints happening. I think also next Sunday there is Messy Church happening. And somebody's already mentioned that Gordon's funeral is on Friday at
10 o'clock
at Test Valley Crim. Okay, 10 o'clock, Test Valley Crim. If you want to be part of that, please do. Is there anything else I need to mention in particular? Oh yes, if you haven't got the newsletter, you want to get it, do sign up for it, it'll be fine. And there's tea and coffee afterwards, so please do stay in. Again, particularly extending a welcome to those who've come from St Martin's, please do hang around, it'd be lovely to get to know you a bit better. It'd be lovely to do that. If this is a result of this, you've come, her service, you've come with a desire for someone to pray for you, please don't leave without that happening. There'll be people on the red chairs in that corner over there at the end of the service waiting to pray. If there's two of them, they're waiting to pray and you're welcome to just go and see them and share what's on your heart. If there's three of them, that means they're probably praying for someone, so go away and do something else and come back. And they'll be ready to do that later on. And it's just helpful because of that going on, if we kind of make our way out of here and leave this space more still, that would be really helpful to give opportunity for prayer to happen. But now our final song is one that later actually draws us into commitment and asks what we're going to do about this in going out and bringing the tender mercy of God to our communities around us. Let's stand to sing, I, the Lord of Sea and Sky.
Dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you and all those whom you love, this day and always. Amen. So go in peace to love and serve the Lord.